Hello everybody, welcome back to my channel where skincare is all about progression over perfection because perfection doesn't exist. And welcome to another episode of When Beauty Turns Ugly. The title, I promise you, is clickbait on purpose. It'll make sense later, okay? Today's topic is one I've actually heard of before. I've got a lot of friends and obviously family who work in the makeup industry, whether that be at retail level or like fashion photo shoot level. And I've heard horror stories like this before. And of course, everything in this video is alleged. My opinion, stuff I personally believe for legal reasons. Just for entertainment purposes only, for legal reasons. And today I'm going to be doing what is currently my evening routine. So I've already cleansed my face with the Bondi Sands something 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 cleanser, which I'll put here. Very nice, very basic. It has kind of like a non-fragrance washing up liquid feel to it, which I actually like, surprisingly, but it doesn't bubble up as much as washing up liquid, obviously. So I'm using the BEAUDIANI Infusing Collagen Concentrate Mist between each step. I'm nearly out of this, so it might be done by the time we finish this video. But yes, so I want to take you back to being a teenager. Remember when you used to have to, like, we didn't have mobile phones, and you'd have to meet up outside Claire's, and then you go around shopping, taking pictures in photo booths, being annoyingly loud for no reason, going to Space NK, Superdrug, Sephora, Ulta, and trying all their testers, all the skincare, makeup, and fragrances testers. The idea of testers and samples makes me feel physically ill now. However, but they're a good idea. And we kind of need them, especially when it comes to makeup being super expensive. What if you want to go out and buy a new lipstick? How are you going to know if it suits you or not? We kind of need these testers. But if you knew that using a tester could give you a disease that would come and go for the rest of your life, would you still use it? We're going to do a little hydrating point mask. That means concentrating on areas that need a little bit more hydration than the rest of your face. This is The Lab Oligo Hyaluronic Acid 7 Multi-Formula Pads. I'm just going to apply these in areas that feel a little bit dry and feel like they need a little bit more hydration. So going back to lifelong disease, unfortunately, that's what happened to the subjects of today's video. So on October the 29th, 2015, plaintiff Elena Davoyan popped to her local Sephora. Specifically, it was the Hollywood and Highland store in LA, California, to purchase a lipstick. She needed a new lipstick, so she went straight to Sephora. And as we've just been discussing, Elena wanted to try on the lipstick before she bought the product, before you commit to paying 30 odd quid or however much it is for lipstick, just to make sure it suited her, you know. There's nothing worse than, not that I would know, but trying to use a lipstick that doesn't suit you. I'm just gonna hydrate. There you go. And just like pretty much everyone who goes shopping in Sephora, she went straight over to the testers and started to try them on. Testers within the biz are known as common use products, so I'll be calling them common use from now on. So Elena bought her lipstick, and pretty soon after, Elena was diagnosed with herpes, professionally diagnosed by the Oliver UCLA Medical Center. She had never had herpes before, never had cold sores before, and she was completely adamant that she got herpes from the common use lipstick. And whilst we don't know the exact brand or the exact shade that she tried, here is a picture of what common use lipsticks usually look like. The brand, to be honest, is irrelevant because it wouldn't be down to the formulation or the brand, it would be down to Sephora's hygiene. So it wasn't actually until much later, 2017, that Elena served Sephora with the lawsuit. This is because herpes, being herpes, comes and goes. So she was living for years with this, and it was pretty much destroying her life, her self-confidence, her image. She decided that it had taken over her life and it was time to sue. But are Sephora actually to blame for this? You know, you go up to common use products knowing that a lot of people are using them. I personally agree with the lawsuit and the lawyers here. So the lawyers actually representing Elena Davoyan, tongue twisters these names, was Crancy Law, who I couldn't actually find any noticeable cases for, but yes, they say that Sephora are 100% to blame. Let's look at the lawsuit. They say basically that Sephora know that customers are coming in and out to try these lipsticks. In fact, Sephora actually supply customers with tools to help remove any testers that they've been using so that they can carry on using testers. I'm just gonna wipe these off. They're going to say there are shelves and shelves of open lipstick tubes for sampling that people try on over and over and over. And they go on to say that Sephora are basically luring in these customers with their common use products, knowing there may be risks, but not caring, basically. They even go on to give examples of better testing and sampling practices that are used in other stores. This, of course, kicked up a media frenzy, anything like this does, because they just want a good headline, right? Something to scare people into reading their headline. Lipstick gives you herpes. But can a common use product like lipstick actually give you herpes? Well, some say yes, some say no. Dermatologist Dr. Whitney Bowe spoke to NBC News back in 2017 about this case, stating that you can catch herpes simplex virus from an intimate object such as lipstick. In fact, the virus can survive on the surface of lipstick tube for up to a week. And it's not just herpes, makeup samples can make you sick any number of ways. I'm going to apply a really hydrating essence now. This is the Jin Jun Sung Soothing Moisture Skin Essence. Deeply hydrating, moisturizing without being sticky, without being heavy. I love this so much. In fact, NBC News took their report one step further. I'm just going to go over my lips as well. They sent an undercover reporter to three very popular makeup stores to collect samples of makeup testers, the common use products, with sterile swabs, and then sent them over to a certified microbiology lab for testing. The results showed that some of the common use products actually tested positive for, and I quote, harmful bacteria, including E. coli and Klebsiella pneumoniae. I don't know who that is. Two types of bacteria normally found in the intestinal tract that are expelled with feces. Dr. Whitney Bowe adds that you could literally be applying and smearing someone else's fecal matter directly onto your lips. On the other hand, however, before we get too carried away, a representative of the American Sexual Health Association told Popular Science Online, we can say that with confidence that while there's a theoretical risk here, the reality is that there is a very minimal likelihood of contracting herpes through lipstick. They actually say the opposite of the dermatologists, and they say the virus doesn't live very long on surfaces, and proving that someone contracted herpes this way would be difficult. Most adults in the US have oral herpes, and in most cases, there's no practical way to pin down when or just how it was contracted. They say the herpes virus is very fragile, and there is currently no documented cases of someone definitely acquiring it from an inanimate object. So at this point, despite actually not being able to talk about the case, Sephora had to make a statement, basically saying, everyone, calm down, stop it. They said, while it's our policy not to comment on litigation, the health and safety of our clients is our foremost priority. We take product hygiene very seriously, and we are dedicated to following best practices in our stores. If that's the case, why don't we talk to someone who actually worked in Sephora and see if this is true? See if this stems down to the staff working in the store. I actually got statements from people who currently work in Sephora as well, obviously keeping their names anonymous, to see what they had to say. See if their training really does transfer to the shop floor. One current employee of Sephora said that before the pandemic, customers would be free to pick up the testers and use them however they please. However, post-pandemic, they have something called assisted testing. So essentially, customers are not supposed to touch the testers themselves, but if they want to try anything out, they have to approach a cast member. And that in terms of training the staff, everyone knows what they're supposed to do, but they have to say from a shopper perspective, they don't always do this. A former Sephora employee said that when they worked there, if a client wanted to try on lipstick, for example, they would normally spray it with alcohol and shave the top part off and then sanitize it again and then follow up with a lip applicator, saying that the store managers were actually quite strict about this testing process. But all in all, the testers were there, available just to be picked up and used. It's important to note as well that whilst herpes is considered a disease and it's usually like joked about, it's usually an insult, it's actually extremely common in a lot of adults. Many, many people have herpes. In fact, it's estimated that in the United States, 47.8% of people aged 14 to 49 have herpes, with 572,000 reported new cases of herpes reported in 2021 alone. That's a lot of people. So the Sephora lipstick lawsuit isn't actually the first time this happened. Let's go back to 2013 and pop over to Brooklyn, New York, to one of Rihanna's concerts. Here's where the clickbait title comes in. So I'm going to re-mist before we go into our serums. Running out. And I'm going to apply this, I don't know the exact name of it, but it's like a bean serum. It's just like firming and helps restore your skin barrier. This is new, but it feels so good on my skin. So, star Kima Greenbridge, who was 28 at the time, was attending one of Rihanna's concerts. It was part of her Diamonds tour, and it just happened to coincide with the release of her MAC collaboration. It was at the Barclays Center on the 7th of May, 2013. Like I said, MAC were there promoting Rihanna's new collaboration, her Riri Woo lipstick, which I believe was kind of like her take on one of MAC's most popular red lipsticks, Ruby Woo. Greenbridge was confronted by some of the MAC workers who were working on this promotional store with a lipstick, with a common use lipstick, wanting to apply the lipstick on her, get her to try it out. The MAC worker managed to get to her face and start applying the lipstick, and Starkima Greenbridge actually said, "Is this product clean?" And reading a direct quote, the representative supposedly said, "Yeah, yeah, yeah," and finished applying the product, the common used tester tube of lipstick, at a concert where they're probably applying it to so many people. Shortly after, Greenbridge, just like Elena, was diagnosed with herpes, never having had a herpes flare-up before, never having cold sores, never having anything, any issues with her lips whatsoever. So she decided to sue MAC, not Rihanna. Like, all the crazy headlines say, if you Google it, it's people being like, Rihanna gives so-and-so herpes, or Rihanna and MAC team up to bring you herpes. It's terrible. It's terrible. The lawsuit that was presented to MAC basically... Oh, by the way... When I'm looking at this stuff, I look at, like, when people have been served, you know, when people are told that they're being sued, and it literally says, "You are being sued." Like, I thought it's something more official. I don't know. Anyway, the lawsuit presented to MAC said, "MAC, look, you haven't trained your staff properly. They're dirty, they're disgusting, they're unsanitary," along those lines. They called the MAC pop-up a trap, a hazard, a nuisance, and basically that the MAC staff were careless and negligent because they weren't cleaning their common use product. They of course say that Greenbridge contracted herpes, that this virus, which she now has on and off for the rest of her life, caused her to suffer from cosmetic deformities, which cold sores can be tiny or they can be huge, leading to mental anguish. Next serum is the Sun by Me Propolis B5 Glow Barrier Calming Serum. This is probably one of the only Sun by Me products I actually really like, but it's moisturizing, it's soothing, it helps obviously repair your skin barrier. I'm just using barrier repair products all the time, whether I need them or not, just because I feel like it could be good practice just to keep the skin barrier happy. And of course, other than wanting compensation, Greenbridge actually said she's suing because she wants the company to be more hygienic in the future, saying that MAC should have known that it was unsanitary, and they were obviously exposing patrons of the concert to possible spread of a disease. Oh my god, one lady got herpes in her eye. In her actual eye. I didn't know that was possible. Tamika Hill was going to New York and she wanted her makeup done professionally, so she went to the MAC in her shopping mall to get her makeup done, which a lot of people do. However, a few days later, she woke up with one of her eyes swollen shut. She went to the emergency room, which we call A&E here in the UK, and she was diagnosed with ocular herpes, literally herpes of the eye. She said she cried herself to sleep and was pretty sure she got it from the MAC counter. There was nowhere else. She didn't do anything else that would have resulted in this. Looking at her interview, she even recalls asking the MAC employee why she wasn't using like disposable brushes or more hygienic kind of ways of applying the makeup. And the makeup artist replied, "Girl, you know I can't beat no face with no disposable brushes." To me, this doesn't mean that she wasn't sanitary or hygienic. The thing is, Tanika also had lupus as well, which exacerbated the herpes. It made it much more aggressive and she ended up losing her job because of this. She tried to do this like the friendly way, but when MAC Estee Lauder refused to pay compensation, she decided to get a lawyer and sue. So I'm going to apply my night mask, sleeping mask. This is the Hanyul Yuja Vita C moisturizer. Good for helping correct post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation, even out skin tone, brighten your skin in general. This is such a good mask. I've only used it a couple times, but I've never used a brightening mask and that was a gel texture that didn't feel like it just sunk into skin and disappeared. This leaves you nicely moisturized, your skin nicely protected from any transepidermal water loss, and it just feels really good on the skin. It smells like lemons. Did anyone successfully sue? These are big companies. This is Sephora and Estee Lauder. So let's go back to the first story, Elena Davoyan. So on April the 2nd of 2019, so 2 years after the lawsuit, 4 years after the incident, her lawyer, Robert Crancy, filed a notice of settlement for the Sephora case. However, no terms were revealed. So we don't know. We don't know what happened. Let's just say she got lots of money, a monthly allowance. She's living her best, newly rich life. Again, I'm just applying the product to my lips. There's a bit of vitamin C in here, but it's not really, you know, anything crazy. So we don't really want to add any actives to the lips. I'm going to add a little bit more hydration to my lips with the Esho Drench Lip Serum. Again, this just deeply, deeply hydrates. So what about Starkeema Greenbridge, who got herpes from Rihanna? That case literally just seemed to go nowhere. Try and find something about the settlement, because I took me weeks and I can't find anything. So again, I'm guessing this was settled out of court for privacy reasons. And Tamika Hill, the same thing. It's being dealt with out of court on confidential terms. I feel like we get no satisfaction, like we don't know who won. Usually when this happens though, I feel like the plaintiff has won because they're getting something. They're obviously getting something. It's not uncommon for brands who are being sued to settle out of court and basically keep things private and confidential to avoid things like high legal costs, tarnishing the name of their brand, like embarrassment. And from what I've seen in cases we'll be talking about in the future, they can usually settle for a lot less than what the plaintiff could get had they gone down the court route, you know? So they kind of meet somewhere in the middle. Two more things. I'm going to seal in all this hydration with the Laneige Lip Glowy Balm. This is the grapefruit flavor. All their flavors taste the same to me. I don't really know. You're just going to put that on thick and heavy. Go to bed with like sticky lips. And then I do wear fragrance to bed because I like to pretend I'm luxury when I'm not. This is, I don't know how to say this, Byredo Baudefrique. I love this. It's like a spicy floral scent and I don't like floral scents at all. But it's like clean linen in a field of not horrible flowers with some spice. I think with COVID and everything going on, there is no way these common use testers are going to be a thing anymore. I hope they're not. Are they still a thing? I hope not. I've not been out shopping for a long time. I feel like if COVID has taught us anything, it's just how easy things can spread. Everyone had that thing, didn't they, where they're like, don't blow out your birthday candles because you're literally blowing on the food you're just about to share with everyone. And the idea of sharing a lipstick with strangers who probably pick up this lipstick 100 times a day, put it on their lips 100 times a day, put it down, it does make my skin crawl. As we know, there are really good hygienic ways to do this. And I think it's important to get this sampling of products done by a staff member who can do it hygienically for you, because getting a lifelong disease that can spring up whenever for the rest of your life just because you want to try on a lipstick or a product or get your makeup done, it doesn't sound great. It's not the route I'd like to go down. I feel terrible for these people. I lived with someone with herpes for a long time. They'd get cold sores all the time, and when it flared up, it really flared up, and it wasn't just a vision thing. It affected their mood so bad, so bad. And I hope the plaintiffs got everything that they wanted. I hope they're living a better life because of it. If you Google lipstick herpes, unfortunately this is something that's been happening over and over and over, so I'm not sure any brand has really learned from it. If anything good can come out of COVID, that sounds stupid, but if anything can come from this with the couple of years we've just had, there's got to be better rules and regulations put in place. Anyway, you can watch the rest of the series here and some general light entertainment here, and I will see you over there.